करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः.
The next poem is Casabianca.
Casabianca. The boy stood on the burning deck whence all but him had fled. The flame that lit the battle's wreck shone around him over the dead. Yet beautiful and bright he stood, as born to rule the storm, a creature of heroic blood, a proud though childlike form. The flames rolled on, he would not go, without his father's word. That father, faint in death below, his voice no longer heard. He called aloud, "Say, father, say, if yet my task be done." He knew not that the chieftain lay unconscious of his son. "Speak, father," once again he cried, "if I may yet be gone." And but the booming shots replied, and fast the flames rolled on. Upon his brow he felt their breath, and in his waving hair, and looked from that lone post of death in still yet brave despair, and shouted but once more aloud, "My father, must I stay?" While over him fast through sail and shroud the wreathing fires made way. They wrapped the ship in splendor wild, they caught the flag on high, and streamed about the gallant child like banners in the sky. There came a burst of thunder sound, the boy, oh where was he? Ask of the winds that far around, that fragments strewed the sea, with mast and helm and pennon fair, that well had borne their part, but the noblest thing that perished there was that young, faithful heart. Felicia Hemans.
Honestly, this poem we do not know how to take. It is a very narration of a very sort of a tragic incident. Felicia Hemans was a probably a great poetess of her time, and this poem is a must study for all the school students. And other great poets like Wordsworth and other poets of her time have recognized the greatness of this poetess also, Felicia Hemans. What this poem describes as an incident is inspired by a real life incident. Probably it was in the Battle of Nile with French and other troops. There was a battle in the middle of the sea, and that is where this young boy Casabianca, who was also a part of the crew or the sailors there, he had been in the ship with his father, who was the admiral and who was in the navy. And though this particular poem does not give any historical account, it is probably inspired by the incident in that battle, and only the poet's description of that particular characteristic of that boy stands out in this poem. That is the message. In fact, Swamiji often says, of all the poems that he has selected in the Select English Poems book, we said that in the very beginning that each and every poem talks about a particular value, maybe one or two also, but a important value is highlighted in the poem, and these values are important for us to get into the deeper study of Vedanta. So essentially the Vedantic message we derive from these poems. We saw in the turkey and the ant also, we saw in the pond also, each and every poem has a particular message. And it is very clear in all other poems. But this poem is sort of, within quotes I am saying, controversial. What is the message that we can derive out of this poem? The story or narrative is very simple again here. The admiral, his father, went in the ship below to attend to some important work there amidst this battle, because he was probably one of the commanders or one of the main persons there. He is there, and he had asked his son Kesabianka to stand up in the deck and wait for his instructions. But in the meantime, in the battle, he was dead. So he was dead in the battle below in the ship, and the enemy ship probably has set this ship on fire. So therefore, in the middle of the ocean, what do? You cannot run, but you have tried to escape with whatever is the spare boat or anything that you have. Also, the people are running helter-skelter. This is what we need to visualize or picturize. But the son has been given clear instruction by the father that he should not move at all. But now it is very clear that everybody's life is in danger in this ship. But the boy will not move in deference to his father's words. So he stands there rock solid. And as he feels that the flame is coming and it is going to catch, obviously it is a question of life and death. So he is desperately shouting to his father, "Sir, father, must I stay, please tell me." Since the father is dead, there is no answer from him. So he asks once more, and he asks for the third time. There is no answer. By which time, the flames have completely surrounded him, and he is, there is no escape for him. And finally, the flames also probably reach a point where in the ship there is explosive material, and the whole ship now explodes. So he is thrown into the sea. And it's a very tragic end to the life of that boy. So Swamiji said many people asked him as to why he included this poem amongst all poems. What does it really convey? Probably if we do not read the message properly, we may even misunderstand. Misunderstand in the sense, it may be looked at from the angle of a stupid boy who is not intelligent enough to protect his life. But is that the message that we want to read here? Why is it considered a great poem? And when we say, again, you can say it is all subject to interpretations of the authors and interpretations of commentators. But if something is having a value as being applauded by great poets of their time, and it has been made as a study material, then there is something else that we need to also understand deep that is given in the poem. Isn't it? That is how we derive messages from incidences, Puranas also. You need a proper commentator and interpreter to get the messages also. So if you say Vishwamitra fell for Menaka and therefore what is the message? So if Vishwamitra himself had no chance, where is the chance for you and me? Let us not try any tapas. That is not the message. Vishwamitra is deliberately lending his name to warn us or give a caution for us as to what is the power of the senses. So that is the message that we need to derive, not going to the character analysis of Vishwamitra there. The essential message in that parable is the senses are powerful, that even for a man who is striving, direct words from Gita, yatato vipi kaunteya purushasya vipashchita, in second chapter, what recently covered by Sunandaji also, it said even as a man is struggling in the spiritual path, it is very tough for him to deal with the senses, because senses in themselves are very powerful. So when that message is given by a great rishi like Vishwamitra meditating and he falls for Menaka like that, if the picture is given, then that message should go deep within us, not to take senses for granted, not to poo-poo the senses. That is the essential message there. Similarly, what is the essential message here? The essential message here is the sort of a great adamantine will of that boy who had implicit faith in his father. That is the message. In fact, a stubbornness, or any character for that matter, how any emotion also for that matter, how you are going to utilize it in your sadhana really counts. It is the same adamantine will that Namadev had, the great Namadev. He saw his father daily doing puja, and he would offer food to God, and as a child he believed that the God eats that food. But what we show is like a naivedya. Naivedya means you are reporting to God and then with his blessings you are eating. That is what daily happens. But he believed that God eats. And one day when he had a chance to do the puja, when his father was not there, as a young innocent child with full belief, he would not budge till God ate the food, is the story. So it is that adamantine will must be there, which will make probably even God do whatever he did. So exactly that is the characteristic shown in this boy, shown by this boy in this poem, that once he has taken his father for whatever it is, its ultimate authority or something, he will implicitly follow the orders or instructions of his father and he will not budge at all. That requires a special strength and characteristics, and it is very important for us to develop that trait when we are in this spiritual path. In Vedanta, the importance of Shraddha is again and again emphasized throughout Gita, throughout all scriptures. In Prakarana Granthas also, when we see the Shat Sampati, the quality of Shraddha comes again and again. Shraddha is translated as faith, but Shraddha is definitely deeper than faith. The Kaivalya that we are doing also starts with that only. Shraddha, Bhakti, Dhyana, Yoga, Devaki, Shraddha. So, Shraddha is not merely a blind faith. Shraddha is a faith that you keep in the words of the Guru and the scriptures. The Guru's words are nothing but the scriptures only, and it is the scriptures that is going to talk. An unflinching faith in that. And then what is done is that you follow up with that in order to go along with it, put in effort to understand, so that the faith with which you started ultimately culminates in knowledge. So we are not merely believers, but we are seekers. Seekers means one who seek the truth. We are not content by merely having a belief. We need to convert that belief into knowledge, a living experience, a realization. So that capacity of you to have that faith till the end, till it transforms your personality, that is called as Shraddha. Now the question arises, on whom will you keep this faith? You will keep this faith on a guru. You will keep this faith on a scripture like Gita. You cannot say that I do not know, I want to know God, let me go and ask my servant here or my rickshaw fellow there or something. I am not talking anything ill about that particular people, but I am saying there must be some basis of your faith or belief. So here it is very clear, the father has taken charge of his son and the son's belief in father is unshakable. So it is exactly like that is the relationship with Guru for us in this path, that he is more than a parent who incubates the disciple in his custody, and then he gives birth to a real human being at the end of our education. So his responsibility is high. To such a person whom you have chosen and gone to learn, in his words, in his instructions, there must be unquestionable faith. Does it mean that we do not use our intellect at all? Does it mean that we should not question at all? No, you must. That is why In chapter 4, verse 34 of Gita, he says, Tadviddhi pranipatena. First he says pranipatena. First go and surrender. That is the devotion of the mind. You have to completely surrender unto the Guru. Because you are at a disadvantageous position and you need knowledge. If you are sick, you have to have some faith in the doctor. If you keep on doubting every doctor, okay, you need not consult any doctor, then but your health will deteriorate. So somewhere you have to fixate some person who you believe can treat you, and to that person there must be absolute surrender. So pranipatena is first given, that there must be absolute surrender, absolute devotion. Prostrating. Pranipata means prostrating. That I submit myself to you completely. It is in this ambit, it is in this background, the next quality comes, pariprashnena. Then whatever is being said, you can definitely clarify your doubts, question, till you understand it is the obligation of the Guru to explain it also. And then sevaya comes as the physical trait, where you are expressing your gratitude by way of service, which is a physical discipline. So in other words, body, mind, intellect, all are employed in the gaining this knowledge. But the essential thing is the surrender of the mind. Because mind completely, the ego completely surrenders, and then you take the implicit instructions of the Guru. There are very many great parables in our, because this Guru-Shishya relationship is given a very, very high value in our Indian tradition, and we saw that in the when we had this glory of Guru celebration of Guru Purnima also. Inspiring examples, Ekanatha, Ekalabhya also we know in Mahabharata. There was a great Vedic Rishi called Uddalaka Aruni. Uddalaka Aruni is the, I think, Rishi in Chandogya Upanishad who gives the most famous statement, Tattvamasi, to his son Shvetaketu. Uddalaka Aruni, that Aruni was a disciple of Rishi Dhaumya. And this story comes in Mahabharata, that Rishi Dhaumya is instructing Aruni and other disciples in his Gurukula. And the disciples fetch firewood and other essential items for the ashram. And as he is with the disciples, a message comes that the field that belongs to the master, Dhaumya, is flooded. The embankment that protects the field on one side is broken, and water is flooding the field, which is to be immediately attended to. Otherwise, it may damage the crops or whatever it is. So he tells Aruni to go and attend to it. Immediately runs there and he sees that it is broken, probably beyond repair. He tries everything to amend it. It does not work. But he has to stop the water at all costs. And what he does is that he puts his body across the broken area of the embankment and stops the water. And it is night, in the shivering cold also, he does not budge at all. Throughout the night he is there like this. Next morning, as the attendance is being taken, and the sage asks, where is Aruni? The others say, yesterday you had sent him to repair the field. And they go there and they could not find him. They shout his name and a feeble voice comes that, Master, I am here. And they go and see that he is there in the field, lying across and stopping. Everybody is very moved, and the Guru immediately tends to him personally and blesses him, and he says, you will be a shining example of Guru Bhakti forever, he says. This itself, like this, various stories are there. A very implicit following of instructions from the disciple point of view alone is enough for him to acquire the knowledge. It is evidenced in very many ways. Now, from the modern point of view, where we have so many gurus, so many teachers, does it really work in Kali Yuga? Does it work in our modern days? These questions will definitely arise. What you have to first understand is the essential relationship based on a person who is a disciple. See, there are people who are called as Vidyarthis. Vidyarthi means one who seeks Vidya. There are people who are Antevasins, who Antevasin is one who stays with the Guru and learns something. But Shishya is different. So like that, like categories of various names of Guru is also there, various names of disciples are there, a student is there, to indicate various various levels of relationship or various aspects of their relationship also. A person who has surrendered himself, that's why I mean I can openly say here also, Swamiji says, I have got many students, and you can say obviously very many followers are there, or you can say devotees are there, but disciples I can count on the fingers, he says. Like that he says, I mean that is his experience over probably 60 plus or 50 plus years of teaching. So a disciple is somebody who is different, who surrenders to the Guru with the aim of self-realization in mind and follows the implicit instruction of a Guru, come what may. That is a disciple. So we see that many people may claim many people, others to be their Gurus. I am a follower of this particular Guru, I am a follower of that particular Master. They may all say, and the others may also be there in their list or something like that. That does not automatically turn into a Guru-Shishya relationship. So only when a person is at that level, understanding the intimate relationship with that Guru, which is much more sacred, intimate than a husband-wife relationship also, they will be able to relate to what is given here as following implicit instructions. Such is the caliber of the Guru, such will be the caliber of the student. But for argument's sake also, if you say, if you take a hypothetical case that if the Guru is not good enough, within quotes, we should not even utter such words, but I am saying, if the Guru is not, or a false Guru, to such a person, if a person completely surrenders, will it work? If he follows the instructions implicitly, will it work? The direct answer is, yes, it will work. But you need to analyze certain things before you come to this conclusion also. Why would you surrender to a person who is a, within quotes again, false Guru? See, we surrender to a person assuming that obviously he is above us, and that is the implicit faith. Where does surrender come? Surrender comes when something is beyond your intellect. So it is this person who we consider, and Guru is taken to be as though representative of Ishvara in the human form, that he is the connection between you and God, and to him you surrender with the aim of absorbing the knowledge. So as far as you are concerned, you will surrender to a person who is definitely above you. Surrender comes only in the area of ignorance, and ignorance is what your intellect cannot judge. It is above your intellect, so you are ignorant of it. With your present level of intellect, if you can easily assess certain people, and let us say you can assess a person at your level or at a lower level, and you know that characteristics of person, and you know about that the conduct of that person, would you try and surrender to that person? It will not come. Naturally, that surrender will come only to the person whom you revere, who you see evolved much more than you. He may not be 100%. But if you are at 20%, even a 60%, 80%, all these people are great Gurus for you only. So to that person only whom you will surrender. And such a person, you need to ask this question, why will he take you for a ride? Because you yourself have chosen a person who is above your intellect. You know that what he is, he has been inspiring you for whatever reason. You see, you also come to a conclusion that this particular person is my doctor, based on certain recommendations, his track record, he has been serving people for long, he has been working in this hospital, and this hospital is reputed, various other corroborative evidences are there. Incidentally, we have released this Role of Faith video, release means we have uploaded that in the YouTube. Probably Anuradha will send you the link on Sunday, or I will send the link or give the link at the end of the lecture. We are talking about this only. In faith, that your intellect helps up to a point, but beyond the point where your intellect cannot help, that is where you need to surrender. And if at any point of time If doubt arises in you, whether this person is, really worth having as a guru or whatever it is, any such doubts or suspicion, you will appreciate that this will be the case with reference to any relationship. Faith cannot be in broken measures. It is either you have faith fully or you don't have faith at all. That's all it is. But what we need to understand is, certain things that are expressed out of great people, great masters, may not reflect what their inner status is. So if you at your level, you are going to project certain characteristics in a person based on what you see in that person, it is probably reflecting your mindset at that point of time. So you give the benefit of doubt and you are able to relate to that person with that implicit surrender at that point of time, that will definitely help. Now assuming, go to the other extreme, that he is indeed a false guru. He is indeed a charlatan. Okay? But for whatever reason, your mind is fixated at 100% and it will not budge. This is a very hypothetical scenario that we are talking about. Go by the spirit of what we say. If you in your mind is fixated that he is God and whatever he says is truth and it is going to definitely help you in the path of evolution, you have no doubt at all. Any amount of talking by any others will not convince you. And we are not talking about a stubborn pigheadedness in a person. We are talking about a genuine conviction in a person. If like that, if you are convinced, even that implicit faith in a false guru will take you to the self, may not be the guru. The guru may not reach, we do not know. But definitely, that is why we say, more than Jesus Christ, what is valuable is the faith in Jesus Christ. If a person has that type of a faith in Jesus Christ, he will definitely save, means he will save, no doubt about it. That faith in you, when you have and when you surrender, that will move mountains, that has that power. And that is the faith that we need to develop. And what we are doing in our Vedanta studies, developing that intellect and other things, is to only ultimately develop this faith in that supreme reality. In that process, it is by God's grace you will encounter with that guru, and that guru you must have full faith, complete, abject surrender. We'll just see the poem here. The boy stood on the burning deck when all but him had fled. All had fled. Everybody had gone except him. The flame that lit the battle's wreck shone round him over the dead. So many people are dead also. And the flame is burning there. Yet beautiful and bright he stood as born to rule the storm. A creature of heroic blood. A proud though childlike form. This shows the characteristic, a person with firm conviction. And that is what is the picture that is given here. A childlike form, but is having that heroism in him, a heroic blood. This is an essential characteristic quality required for a spiritual seeker, that you must stand your ground in your pursuit. That is very much required there. The flames rolled on. He would not go without his father's word. The father faint in death below, his voice no longer heard. The father obviously is dead. So his voice is not heard at all. And this is given in italics by Swamiji, that he called aloud, "Say father, say if it may task me done." So in this poem, it is a question of life and death. So obviously there is a self-preservation and all those instincts which is there, naturally it will be there in that boy also. So he is shouting aloud, "Say father, say if my task be done." This may not exactly fit into what we gave as the guru-shishya relationship in that sense, but this can be somewhat equated to that you are allowed to question. In that sense you can take this, that he is questioning. "Say father, say if it may task be done." But sadly, in this poem, he doesn't get the answer because the father is dead. So, you cannot compare that aspect completely to what we talked about is in the guru-shishya relationship there. He knew not that the chieftain lay unconscious of his son. "Speak, father, once again," he cried, "if I may yet be gone." But the booming shots replied, and fast the flames rolled on. No, no answer, but the fire is spreading. Upon his brow, he felt their breath, and in his waving hair, it has now reached him. He can feel the heat near his face. He can feel it now, and his waving hair. And look from the lone post of death in still yet brave despair. He is despair, but there is a brave despair. And shouted but once more aloud, "My father, must I stay?" He asked for the last time, "My father, must I stay?" While o'er him fast drew sail and shroud, the wreathing fires made way. The shrouds are the cloths that are used for covering there, and all through that, through the sail, now that has caught fire. The wreathing fire, meaning it's encircling, and it has come near him. They wrapped the ship in splendor while they caught the flag on high, and streaked above the gallant child like banners in the sky. Now it has caught up everything, and like a banner itself, the flame is there in the middle of the ocean there. There came a burst of thunder sound. That's probably when the explosives has caught fire, and there is a complete explosion now. The entire ship is going to sink and gone, or already damaged. The boy, oh, where was he? Ask of the winds that far around with fragments stood in the sea. It has completely broken him into pieces, and all are scattered in the sea. With the mast and helm and pennon fair, with the mast is the pole there, and the and the flag and the wheel that is used to change the direction of the rudder, that well had borne their part. But the noblest thing that perished there was the young faithful heart. All of these also were, like all these parts of the ship were fighting as it were. And finally they also succumbed. Everything was gone. But what was the noblest thing that perished? The noblest thing that perished there was the young faithful heart. According to me, even the last line needs to be italicized. That is the key message in the poem. Young faithful heart. That faithful heart is the essential quality required in a disciple. We will just take up Swamiji's commentary.
The father in the poem asked his son to remain on the ship's deck. He went down to attend to work. While he was engaged in his work below, the ship caught fire. The father perished in the flames. The boy stood on the burning deck. He would not move. In deference to his father's instruction, the flames rolled on and consumed him. The poem may seem to glorify a mere submission by an unintelligent boy, but it carries a deep message that faith is of vital importance in spiritual practice. The Supreme God is unknown. You need a guru, preceptor, to embark on the pursuit of the unknown reality. Once you have established faith in a guru, the father in the poem, you must implicitly follow his instructions. The poet highlights this great quality in a spiritual practitioner.
Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.